Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Michael Wesley. I'm the Director of the School of International Political and Strategic Studies here at the ANU, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the 32nd Annual Indonesia Update. Since 1981, the Indonesia Update has been the largest annual conference on Indonesia in the world outside of Indonesia itself. For over a quarter of a century, the Indonesia Update has gathered together Indonesia specialists and Indonesia watchers from across Australia and around the world. Today, among us are academics, journalists, students, politicians, diplomats, and government officials. Welcome all. The Indonesia Update was founded in 1981 by the two titans of Indonesian studies at the ANU, Heinz Arndt and Jamie Mackey. Their tradition of the close study of the politics, economics and society of Indonesia continues to live on strongly here at ANU. In just the School of International Political and Strategic Studies, we have the largest collection of specialists studying Indonesian politics anywhere in the world outside of Indonesia. And we have an unprecedented commitment to sharing our knowledge and analysis. For over half a century, the ANU has been teaching students about Indonesia and teaching students from Indonesia. Currently, no fewer than four members of the Indonesian Cabinet are ANU alumni. The ANU's Indonesianists have a long history of interacting closely with governments about the challenges and choices facing Indonesia. And more recently, the new Mandala blog, based in the School of International Political and Strategic Studies, has become the most read English language blog on Indonesian politics. During the recent Indonesian elections, daily reads of New Mandala topped 120,000, or more than 5,000 per hour. The ANU's commentary on the Indonesian election was picked up and used by one of the candidates in the presidential election. The study of Indonesia is a defining tradition and strength of the ANU. Indonesia is in our DNA. And the theme of this year's Indonesia Update is the SBY years. I believe we'll look back on the SBY decade as one of the most consequential in Indonesian history. It was a decade that began with the Australian Embassy bombing and the second Bali bombing, and with the devastating tsunami in December of 2004. But it became so much better as the years passed. The remarkable success of Indonesia against extremism, the strong performance of its economy, the consolidation of democracy, and the unprecedentedly high diplomatic profile of Indonesia, linked no doubt to the skills and profile of its president. Here in Australia, the SBY decade and the bilateral relationship has been tumultuous, but I think ultimately positive. There have been lows. SBY is the only Indonesian president to recall an ambassador to Australia, and he did it twice. But for all of the Chappelle Corbys, the Oceanic Vikings, and the Snowden revelations, the remarkable thing is how resilient the relationship has been and how quickly it has bounded back from its lows. This year saw an unprecedentedly high level of attention here in Australia to the dynamics of the Indonesian election. In my view, no foreign election, other than the US presidential election, has gained so much attention in Australia. So I look forward to the discussions over the next 2 days. I thank the conveners, Ed Aspinall, Marcus Mietzner, and Dirk Thomser, and all of the team in the Indonesia Project that has made this update possible. And I thank you all for coming. I hope you're looking forward to the discussions as much as I am. And now, without further ado, I'd like to hand over to Gemma Purdy to start the first session. Thanks, Gemma.
Okay, good morning, everyone, and thank you for taking your seats so promptly. As chair of this session, the political update, my primary goal here is to make sure that everybody runs on time. So I'll be very brief with the introductions of our speakers, who I'm sure are well known to most of you here. Our two speakers today, we have two speakers and one discussant. Our two speakers include Ed Aspinall, who's a professor of politics in the Department of Political and Social Change in the School of International Political and Strategic Studies here at the ANU College of Asia and the Pacific. Ed has published extensively on the politics of Southeast Asia, especially Indonesia, including its opposition movements and democratisation. His co-presenter is Marcus Mietzner, who is also Associate Professor at the ANU College of Asia and the Pacific. Like Ed, he's published extensively on Indonesian politics, and his recent research is focused on political parties in Indonesia, and recently the PDIP in particular. Our discussant is Douglas Ramage, who is Managing Director of Bauer Group Asia in Indonesia, a business advisory firm. Previously, Doug worked as Senior Governance Advisor to the World Bank, Australian Aid, and the Asia Foundation. All three speakers have, as I said, published extensively on politics in Indonesia and are leading commentators in the field. We welcome them and look forward to their discussion today. Ed, thank you.
Thank you, Gemma, and good morning, everyone. It's our contention in our political update talk this year that 2014 deserves to be remembered as an historic watershed year for Indonesian politics and Indonesian democracy, arguably second only to 1998 in its recent history for its significance. Part of the reason, of course, is, as we've heard, this is the end of the SBY presidency, the first directly elected president in Indonesian history, and the first president to be democratically re-elected. But most of all, we believe it's because of Indonesian democracy's near miss this year. In the presidential election, as we're all aware and we remember very well, we saw a contest between two very different candidates. Joko Widodo, Jokowi, is very much a product of Indonesian democracy itself, and in many ways stands for Indonesian democracy's deepening. His opponent, Prabowo Subianto, promoted an authoritarian populist message suggesting very strongly that he wanted to re-centralize political power and wind back key democratic reforms. In the end, as we all know, Jokowi won, but with a margin of 6.3%, which was much narrower than many people had predicted. And the narrow margin of his victory, and therefore the narrow victory we would contend for Indonesian democracy, therefore demands serious consideration and explanations by observers of Indonesia's democracy itself. Our account of 2014 in the talk and the paper we've written today focuses on this challenge of explaining how Indonesian democracy came so close. And we offer two sets of explanations. One focuses on the details of campaign organization and strategy, with Prabowo having run a lavishly funded, single-mindedly focused and highly professional campaign that mobilized substantial oligarchic support. Jokowi, on the other hand, of course, running in many ways a charming but rather ramshackle presidential campaign, dogged by, amongst other problems, a problematic relationship with his own political party. But the second set of explanations we turn towards highlights underlying political conditions. We will argue that as the sun began to set on the SBY presidency, Indonesia was experiencing many underlying conditions to favour populist alternatives. And we argue that both SBY and Jokowi, although in very different ways, represented forms of populism. However, these conditions were not enough or not severe enough to amount to a groundswell of support for an authoritarian reversal. in particular, as we'll demonstrate, public support for democracy remains very high in Indonesia. And the ultimate explanation for the outcome of the presidential election, we think, strongly lies in these underlying conditions. The structure of our talk today is divided into four sections or four phases. In the first section, we'll talk. I'll talk about the context, in particular the early part of the year, setting the scene for the presidential election in the context of the end of the SBY presidency. I'll then, in the second section, talk briefly about the parliamentary election in April. And then my colleague Marcus will take over to present an analysis of the third section, which is the presidential campaign, an analysis of the outcome, and then fourthly, the aftermath. So the context, of course, for the momentous events we've witnessed this year were the end of the SBY years. As SBY came to the end of his presidency, he had many reasons to be satisfied with himself. As we're going to explore for much of this conference, the country enjoyed political stability under his rule. There was a respectable rate of economic growth. Indonesia largely avoided the worst of the global financial crisis, and many other reasons and causes for celebration. And yet, Indonesians also had plenty to be disappointed about. In preparation for this talk, I looked back at the political update paper that was written by Rizal Sukma in 2009 at the beginning of SBY's second term in office. And part of his paper at that time focused on the speculation that was then in circulation in Jakarta that SBY would use the huge mandate that he achieved in that presidential election of this year to launch bold reforms. And Rizal addressed the question how successful SBY might be in seizing the momentum of his second term to be a really bold, reforming president. Well, we now know that the answer was that SBY did not seize the momentum and that he did not become a boldly reforming president. Of course, there were some policy successes, but it's hard to think of any that were unqualified achievements. And even every bit of silver in the SBY record has something of a cloudy lining. So poverty, for example, as we know, came down, but inequality worsened. And we still have over 40% of the population living under $2 a day. SBY's personal reputation, of course, also suffered throughout this period. And his reputation as perhaps a rather pompous, rather remote, and rather vacillating, paragu is the Indonesian word, president became more and more cemented in the public mind during his second term. And this was reflected in the polling numbers measuring his popularity. So just after he was elected in November 2009, SBY had 75% approval ratings. April 2010, 63%. January 2011, 57%. June 2011, 47%. May 2013, 30%. So we saw just a plummeting of his approval ratings. A slight bounce in 2014, perhaps as people started to get nostalgic about his era, but nevertheless, great public disappointment. And this sense of stasis very much continued into his final year. In fact, at points it seemed to be that SBY was reveling in his lame duck status during 2014. So, for example, we saw him at one point saying that he didn't want to take any rash decisions, which could become a time bomb for the next president. So, for example, again, we saw him balking at the idea of cutting fuel and electricity subsidies. 2 points deserve particular notice here, which helped set the scene of the early part of 2014. Firstly is corruption. The SBY years can also really be thought, and I think will be thought of in retrospect, as the KPK years, the years where the Anti-Corruption Commission really began to cut a swathe through Indonesia's political elite. It was very much the defining issue of the SBY presidency, in my view. And in some ways can be seen as a success of President SBY, that he allowed this very effective anti-corruption institution to even target very big scalps. The problem for the president, of course, was in the last 2 or 3 years, KAPEKA investigations have come closer and closer to the presidential palace itself, and in particular to his party, the Partei Demokrat. So we saw the spectacle this year of Anas Urbaningrum, for example, the general secretary of the party being detained in February and tried. Andy Malarangeng, another senior Partei Demokrat official, Minister of Youth and Sports, was sentenced to four years jail in July. We saw other ministers being detained, or being charged, I should say, by the KPK. Suryadharma Ali, the Minister of Religion, in May for a scandal in Hajj funds. Jero Wacik, another Partei Demokrat grandee and Minister of Energy and Minerals, in September. So we saw very much the taint of corruption, which had been, or the fight against corruption, which had been arguably a positive for President Yudhoyono earlier in his period in office, now becoming very much a negative for him, given that it was hitting so close to home. The other extraordinary development, or rather a non-development, which I think does worth mentioning, at least in passing, was SBY's inability to prepare the ground for a successor from within his own party. It's really extraordinary that the president, who has been so lauded as a success in many ways, was unable to cultivate a political successor from within his own camp. Early on, I'm sure many of us remember that early on in this second term, there was much speculation that he would choose someone. Joko Suyanto was one name that was mentioned, Andy was another, or even perhaps his wife, Ibu Ani. There was a lot of speculation about that too, as I'm sure many of us will recall, that he would choose one and start to promote that person to the public as a future presidential candidate. But the problem was, as in so many things, SBY seemed just never to be able to make up his mind, and he was obsessed with the polling results for these individuals. The party, or his Partei Demokrat, struck on borrowing from US political practice and organizing what they said was a convention. There are 11 candidates for the presidential nominee, though in the end, rather than a popular vote, it ended up using polling. Again, very characteristic of SBY's approach. But the problem was that because of the sorts of problems I've alluded to here, the growing disillusionment with Partei Demokrat because of corruption, and also because of the rise of alternative candidates, when this so-called convention finally finished, Dahlan Iskan was the eventual winner, nobody really cared very much. And the idea that the Partei Demokrat would be able to launch a credible presidential nominee had pretty much crashed. So, in summary then, this was the situation that Indonesia went into at the beginning of 2014. Political conditions were generally stable, the economy was in reasonable shape, but there was also rather deep political disillusionment, at least with aspects of governance and of government. Conditions were ripe, in other words, for a populist challenger to the status quo. And in fact, political scientists had been predicting for years that a populist presidential candidate would eventually emerge in Indonesia. There's a big political science literature on populism and what populism represents. Just very briefly, a populist politician is generally considered to be someone who represents the ordinary masses or the ordinary people, but by way of direct, personalized, and unmediated connections with the populace, bypassing standard political institutions. Populist politicians typically emerge in conditions when a good part of the population are alienated from established political institutions, often in conditions of economic stagnation or crisis, or alternately, or sometimes at the same time, disillusionment driven by considerable corruption within the political class. Indonesia in 2014 had a choice of not one but two populist candidates. And critically, they were not just populists of very different types, but they were populists who picked up on different aspects of popular alienation with SBY himself. So in Jokowi, we had a candidate who had a popular touch, which was very much the antithesis of SBY's wooden formality. In Prabowo, we had a leader who promised, above all else, firm leadership, strong leadership, and the antidote to SBY's reputation as a paragu, as a vacillator. Now, I won't rehearse, partly because I'm aware of the passage of time, and I'm sure Marcus will never forgive me if I cut into his allocated 20 minutes. So I won't spend too much time rehearsing what many of us already know about these two candidates. Jokowi's rise to prominence through 2013, in the polls, formally, of course, elected as the mayor of Solo and then governor of Jakarta. And his version of populism was, you might think of it as a sort of a cultural populism. He's the sort of person who's able to strike up an immediate rapport with ordinary people and does so through his trademark blusukan, these kind of meet the people form of campaigning. But his politics in many ways are not avowedly populist. In many ways, he really stands for improved government services, and he pays a lot of attention to the intricacies of bureaucratic delivery and bureaucratic administration. Prabowo Subianto, and I apologize for him there, it's not a very flattering photo, of course has a very different sort of background, comes from the heart of the New Order elite, a major oligarch in his own right. Of course, the background is as a senior general with a very problematic human rights record. But his message was very strongly and classically populist. He stressed three basic messages: that the poor in Indonesia are downtrodden and neglected, that this neglect had two sources. Firstly, a political class that is irredeemably corrupt. And if you look at a lot of his speeches, he really emphasizes this. One point, for example, he said something like, if I meet 15 people in politics, 14 of them are liars. And secondly, the second source, I won't comment on that. The second source was that Indonesia is exploited by foreigners and that Indonesia needed a new form of national renaissance. The third item in his program was that for all these problems that Indonesia had, there was a single solution, and that was strong leadership, of course, to be provided by Prabowo Subianto. So all of the styling of his campaign, the uniform, the old-fashioned microphones, the marching bands, the horses, all of that sort of stuff was all designed to reinforce this message. There was an authoritarian element, I won't go into this as well in great detail, but in particular it was central to his program to return to the 1945 constitution, which is an authoritarian document. The problem for Prabowo, however, is that he very much presented himself as a classic sort of crisis candidate, a candidate appealing to a deeply disillusioned populace. The problem was, of course, that it wasn't that clear that the crisis was so deep that the masses were hungering for the sort of leader that Prabowo offered. We can see here, for example, that basically the population, there are many polls on this, are basically supportive of democracy. And even if they're asked the question about their satisfaction with how democracy is actually functioning, as we see in this poll by Saiful Mujani, the blue line is satisfaction, the red line is dissatisfaction. You can see that Indonesians generally, over the last 10 years, have been satisfied with the functioning of Indonesian democracy, and that satisfaction was actually rising as the election approached. Now, I'll just very briefly talk about the parliamentary election. There's some figures for you to digest. Usually, if this was a standard political update in an election year, we would spend a lot of time analysing the results of the election. But really, this year, I think, of the parliamentary election, this year, we really saw the parliamentary election being overshadowed by the presidential poll. So there were some results, some trends of interest to note. Partai Demokrat, SPY's party, fell by half. PDIP, Jokowi's party, rose once again to reclaim the first position, something it hadn't held since 1999. Gurindra, Prabowo's party, more than doubled, and so on. But in many ways, the biggest and the most interesting feature of the parliamentary elections was not so much the trends in party representation overall at the national level, but rather what was happening at the ground. And this, I think, it really does deserve note, although it's not directly connected to... I might go over by 1 minute. Sorry, Marcus. Not directly connected to our presidential campaign, is that this was, I think, the parliamentary election which was universally agreed to have the most flagrant, the most blatant, and the most intense money politics that we have yet witnessed. That the open list proportional representation system adopted as a result of a constitutional court decision in 2009 really bore fruit this year in the form of widespread, massive vote buying in many electorates. I won't go into the reasons for this or its various manifestations. Just sufficient to say that we certainly can't see this as a basis for the nature of the ensuing presidential election, but it's part of the background, I think. And certainly Prabowo tried to link the spread of money politics and vote buying in the parliamentary elections to his own message about the corruption of the political class. For example, he said on a number of occasions, if people offer you money for your vote, take the money, but still vote for Gurindra. Of course, it was often Gurindra candidates who were distributing money in the first place, but we'll leave that aside. All right, I'll leave it there, setting up for Marcus. Because one of the other points that's worth mentioning at the end of the parliamentary election was that this was really a point at which we began to see that the wheels might be starting to fall off Jokowi's rise, seemingly smooth path towards the presidential palace. At the beginning of the parliamentary campaign period, there was a 36-point gap between Jokowi and Prabowo in the polls. By the end, that gap had shrunk to 16%. And the reasons for why this was happening, well, my colleague will go into that in the next session. Thank you.
So very soon after the parliamentary elections were over, the parties, including Jokowi and Prabowo, moved towards coalition building. As you may know, in Indonesia, presidential candidates are nominated by parties or coalitions of parties that have reached 25% of the votes or 20% of the seats in the preceding parliamentary poll. So that means that whoever wants to run for the presidency needs to put together a coalition. And it was very interesting to see that both candidates used very, very different approaches to coalition building, and they used approaches that were rather at odds with their political character. On the one hand, Jokowi, who was seen as a moderate, as a pragmatist, as a soft-spoken politician, he used a hardline approach towards coalition building. He said, I will only form coalitions with parties that have no conditions for cooperating with me. So if you like to support me, that's fine, but you can't ask for any concessions, for any rewards. And he stuck very consistently to that line, and that led a lot of parties to turn their backs to him, Golka, PAN, Partei Demokrat, and others that actually were interested in working with him because of his good polling numbers, then went different ways because Jacobi did not want to engage in any coalition power sharing. So the coalition that Jacobi managed to put together was rather small. Of course, the main element of that coalition was PDIP, his home party. Then you had also the traditionalist Muslim party PKB. You had Hanura, led by former Armed Forces Commander General Rianto, and you had Nasdem, led by media tycoon Zoya Palloch. All together, they only held around 39% of the seats in parliament. On the other hand, Pobobo, who, as Ed has already explained to you, had a very tough man image, said, I'm not going to work with these corrupt bastards of Indonesian politics who are all liars and who cheat Indonesians out of their rightful resources, and so on, and so on. He had a very integrationist approach to a coalition building. He was prepared to enter into power-sharing arrangements with any party that came to him. In fact, the impression was that he was prepared to do anything to get the nomination together. So he had in his coalition then a lot of parties, a lot of figures that were of rather questionable reputation, again for somebody who had identified political corruption as one of the major flaws of Indonesian democracy. That was rather surprising. You see here, and Ed mentioned that, Suryadharma Ali, for instance, who was just days after he had agreed to support Prabowo, indicted by the KPK for corruption. You, of course, had PKS, whose president had just been sentenced to 16 years in prison for corruption, and then you had Abdurizal Bakri, the head of Golka, about whose reputation I don't have to say much more. You also had Hatta Rajasa, who himself didn't have any corruption allegations against him, but he was, of course, supported by oil import magnate Riza Khalid, who was operating in the background. Yudhoyono also finally came around to support the coalition. So after all that negotiation, Pobowo had a coalition together that controlled around 60% of the seats in parliament. These different approaches to coalition building were also reflected in very different campaign styles. Ed has already mentioned in the parliamentary campaign, the weaknesses of Jokowi as a campaigner became apparent. There was no clear campaign message. It was all very amateurishly organized. Chaos was reigning throughout the campaign. Often events were canceled at short notice. To the ones that he actually did come, he was often 4 or 5 hours late. There was no coherent campaign coming together. Part of the problem, of course, was that significant elements of his own party, PDIP, were not on board with his campaign. So what we then had was a campaign largely driven by his volunteers. Jacobi did try to frame his campaign after it was clear there was a lack of a message. He came up with this idea of a mental revolution that until now I failed to understand what exactly it means, and I'm sure a lot of Indonesians share that frustration, but they believed at the time it was a quick fix to that problem of a lack of a campaign message. On the other hand, you had Prabowo Subianto, who had a very different approach. Ed mentioned that already. He had access to a lot of resources, a lot of oligarchic support, in contrast to Jokowi, who made his way through Java in cars, and really pushed himself to the brink of exhaustion. Pabowo here had his private plane. He had very few campaign events he chose to attend, maybe one or two a day, after which he would fly back to his ranch in Bogor and rest there. There were reports about him consuming Big Macs on his private plane in a very sort of relaxed manner. But his was a campaign of classic oligarchic machine politics. He had people on the ground who were organizing networks for him, village heads, Islamic leaders, community leaders of other kinds were integrated into the Pabowo political machine, often with material rewards. Very importantly as well was the fact that the parties that were working for Pabowo turned out to be very effective. That's something we, as scholars who work on political parties and have said over many years that political parties actually don't matter that much in presidential campaigns, need to take into account and revise our stance on that. The numbers are very clear. At the end of the campaign, 81% of PKS voters supported Pabowo. That was up from 53% 2 weeks earlier. 56% of Gorkha voters supported Pabowo. That was up from 43% 2 weeks earlier. And 50% of Democratic voters also supported Pabowo, up from 37% 2 weeks prior. So it was very clear that the party machines were working, and they're working successfully for Pabowo. One of the major elements, however, of this campaign was a very effective smear campaign against Jokowi. Starting in early May, there were rumors spread that indeed Jokowi was not who he said he was, and that was a carpenter from Solo, but in fact, as was claimed, he was the son of a Singaporean Christian. And at the beginning, that seemed to be like a bad joke, but then it spread throughout the archipelago and was systematically used against Jokowi. And as Jokowi himself believed, that was actually the part of the campaign that hurt him most. This began to show then in the trend of election support. As Ed has mentioned, the decline actually started to in the parliamentary campaign. If we see the decline over time, in fact, there was this huge gap in December 2013 where Jokowi had a support of 62% against Pabowo's 39%, but that decline accelerated during the parliamentary elections and then continued throughout the presidential poll. You see the numbers here. So a very significant decline, which again, Jokowi believed it was largely because of the smear campaign, but I think it's fair to say there were other factors as well. The very effective campaign that Pabowo drove, the organized nature of the campaign, and as Ed also mentioned, he did have a very questionable message, but at least it was a coherent one. He drove it home very, very consistently, and that contrasted sharply with Jokowi's struggle for having a message at all. What the polls at the time revealed was not only that Jokowi was in decline, but the polls also showed a very interesting demographic patterns. And once again, the demographic patterns of the electorate were very surprising. Remember that Pabowo was a classic populist who appealed mostly to the rural poor, just like Thaksin had done, just like Hugo Chavez has done, just like many of the other classic populists in world history have done. But as you see in some of this polling here, in fact, Pabowo was more popular among the affluent, educated, urban electorate, while Jokowi took most of the rural poor for which Pabowo had actually tried to get their support. You also see again here education. Pabowo was way more popular with voters who had high levels of education. Jokowi more popular among those voters with lower education and income, the same thing. Jokowi taking the poorer voters, while Pavovo was more successful among the affluent. What does that tell us? Well, it tells us that despite the campaign messages that both candidates were presenting, at the end of the day, a lot of voters went for the social demographic background of the candidate. That means that poorer rural Indonesians were attracted by Jokowi's image as a humble carpenter from humble backgrounds in a small town in Java, while a lot of the affluent urban voters went for the candidate they believed was much closer to their own demographic profile. But as a lot of people, and including Ed and myself, and you know, diplomats, foreign journalists, believed that Pavovo was winning, the miracle happened. The bounce happened in around the last week of the campaign, 10 days before the campaign, after month and month of decline for Jokowi and month of rise for Pavovo, that suddenly stopped. Jokowi gained slightly. These are the Saiful Mujani numbers. Other numbers were a little bit stronger in the last 10 days of the campaign. And when I spoke to the campaign at the time, they said, it's a miracle. We can't actually explain why that happened. We can only say this must be divine intervention. And while that is certainly true, let me try to offer four explanations for that bounce in the last 10 days. Number one, Pavovo made a strategic mistake in that last phase of the campaign. Up until then, he had been very successful in trying to conceal his anti-democratic agenda. He was very clear on his populist message that he wanted the people to get more benefits from the polity in which they were living, but he had not been very clear about what exactly he was trying to do with Indonesian democracy. That was partly the failure of Jokowi, of course, not to push him to the extent that would have forced Prabowo to make that open. But in off-the-cuff remarks at that time, in a speech on culture in Taman Ismail Marzuki, Pavovo finally let go. Probably he didn't think there was media present, but the speech was recorded and ended up in Kompas. He did say that direct elections in Indonesia were un-Indonesian, were not in line with Indonesian culture. They were an import by the West. In fact, they were similar to a very bad habit like smoking, and it was very difficult to get rid of. So finally, we've seen Pavovo in his real political agenda. And that was happening at a time, and that's the second factor I want to refer to, that was happening in a time in which traditionally in all elections around the world, people have a second look at their choice. People reflect on their longer-term political commitments and try to make up their minds. So while not a lot of Indonesians were affected by what Pavovo was saying at the time about democracy, a sufficiently large number of voters did find it questionable and readjusted their choice. This was particularly relevant because we know from the voter movements between December 2013 and towards the end of the election that 15% of the Pavovo electorate were former Jokowi voters who actually supported Pavovo not because of his anti-democratic agenda, but because they were disappointed with Jokowi's lack of a campaign message. The solidity of Jokowi's core support is also very important. It turned out that although there was this constant decline in his support, he never fell below 47%, never, throughout the entire period. And that showed that his core constituency, the rural, the poor, the undereducated, they were very loyal in their support towards Jokowi, while Pabowo, on the other hand, had built up his support over just several weeks, basically. And a lot of these voters, around half of his electorate, in fact, have to be categorized as soft voters. And we in East Java spoke at the time to Pabowo's chief pollster, and he, in fact, predicted already that Jokowi would win because his electorate was much more loyal and would turn out stronger at voting day. Finally, the fourth factor, was a very strong performance of Jokowi and his team in the last week. There was this concert on the Saturday before the election, which mobilized a lot of people. This photograph here was sent throughout Indonesia and impressed a lot of voters. It gave that impression of a groundswell of support for Jokowi. He added to that by a very good performance in the last televised debate with Pabowo on that very night. So the mood, as you will, as we went into voting day, was strongly in Jokowi's favor, and that led to this result here. At the end, it was a pretty clear result, 53.15 to 46.85. The Jokowi camp took 23 provinces to Pabowo's 10. Now, the debate before the elections was pretty much marked by this controversial question of how anti-democratic is Pabowo really? Is he a real threat to Indonesian democracy, or is that something that foreign observers simply have made up and that the Jokowi camp is exploiting? And that was, you know, the view that a lot of foreign businessmen, for instance, held. Well, you know, the Pabowo, the real Pabowo is the one in a suit and who tells us he's a pragmatist. You know, he is only using this radical rhetoric in order to gain votes. Once he's elected, he will be fine. That was a view that was also endorsed by a lot of voters, as Ed has mentioned as well. Polls showed that a lot of voters who were in favor of democracy also supported Pabowo, suggesting that they did not interpret their vote for Pabowo as opting out of democracy. However, after the elections were over, we gained a real insight into what Pabowo really was like. There were four things he did that really highlighted his anti-democratic profile, his anti-democratic thinking. Number one, he manipulated quick counts after he had clearly lost the elections. He simply fabricated quick counts that showed that he had won, and he had these quick counts published in TV stations that were either owned or associated with his allies. Number two, his camp attempt to intervene in the vote count. These attempts were very clear. There's a photograph here of Hashim, who was flying through Papua at the time where voting took place. Reports suggested every time he landed, there was a big suitcase unloaded from his plane, and he was not very happy about questions that went towards the content of those suitcases. Number three was the attack on the Constitutional Court after he had been declared the loser by the Electoral Commission. He shifted his focus towards the Constitutional Court, and as he realized that even the Constitutional Court would be voting against him, he decided that his ducks should have a go at the Constitutional Court at the day the verdict was read out. So there was an attack on that court, presumably with the goal of stopping the reading out of the verdict, but the police was there and prevented it from happening. Fourth, he then, after having also been declared the loser by the Constitutional Court, he pushed for the abolition of direct local elections. It's currently something that's still going on in Parliament, again, trying to implement that thought that he had raised in Taman Ismail Marzuki into political practice. Jokowi was pretty unmoved by all of that, what was going on. He put his team in place to take over. For the first time in Indonesian history, we have had a transition team modeled along, of course, the US model. And this is what we've been seeing over the last weeks or so. There are a number of teams that Jokowi has put in place that prepare him to take over the presidency. And if some of his interviews are a good guideline for what we can expect, he plans to start his presidency with a big bang, and that is getting rid of the fuel subsidies that all of us have agreed for decades, in fact, are a complete travesty and need to go. He is committed to that, and probably by early November we'll see that happening. So conclusions here, as Ed mentioned, 2014, the elections were a seminal moment, only comparable to 1998. And it also, at the more international stage, it comes to relief to democracy theorists who have been frustrated by the abortion of the Arab Spring and other democratic reversals like the coup in Thailand. So it is very good news indeed for democracy around the world. Secondly, the result actually challenges deeply entrenched preconceptions about Indonesian politics. Number one, that only rich, well-connected people can become president. We've seen a carpenter from Central Java becoming president in Indonesia, and that certainly means something. Number two, it challenges the notion of Indonesia being dominated by oligarchs. Of course, Jokowi had support from some oligarchs, but the whole notion that he is a puppet of the oligarchs, I think, is very much misplaced. And thirdly, we also have had this notion in the last 10 years about Indonesian elections in particular, that they are about nothing anymore, that parties are indistinguishable, that voters don't have an alternative anymore, and that Indonesia is ruled by one big political cartel in which elections don't fulfill any function anymore. That notion, I think, has also been challenged. However, and we don't want to underestimate this point, you know, the elections also highlight the continued vulnerability of Indonesia's young democracy, the fact that Prabowo, an icon, and probably the worst icon of the New Order regime, was able to mobilize 47% of voters needs to give us some material for thought. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I'll just straight away introduce Doug Ramage to come up as discussant, and then we'll have some time for questions.
Thanks, Gemma. Democracy did indeed have a close call in 2014, and Ed and Marcus, I think, have beautifully laid this out as it transpired and the analysis of it in the five phases that are covered in their paper. It's superb. I wanted to read 40 pages, not 20, so if there's extra room in the book, you should go for it. After all, you're the editors. So as is the tradition of most discussants, many discussants at the update, I would not so much like to take issue with anything in the paper in a critical sense, in large measure because I concur with the analysis and feel it's a spot-on reflection of the year in politics in Indonesia. But I'd rather expand on a reference that's made in the paper, an important one, and perhaps to add another piece to the narrative of what this election meant for Indonesia. And unfortunately for Indonesia, I think, and ultimately unfortunately for Indonesians, as well as Indonesia's trading partners, there was nothing like a close call when it came to how democratic politics dealt with the extraordinarily consequential questions of dealing with Indonesia's economy, with massive implications, I believe, for the country's growth and prosperity trajectory. So in other words, as a result of this election, I think, while democracy is safe, Indonesia's prosperity is not. This year has been a year in which politicians from all sides bought in publicly and rhetorically to many of the worst economic policy directions of the latter half of the SBY decade. And these are policies which have slowed growth and damaged Indonesia's prospects to escape what many of us worry is Indonesia being stuck in the lower middle income trap. Many of these views are expressed by politicians who desperately want Indonesia to escape that lower middle income trap, but they're in the campaign, there was very little distinction between many of the essential policy prescriptions that came from the parties in the legislative campaigning before April, as well as in the presidential campaign. As Ed and Marcus say in the paper, it was a consequential year in that anti-foreign sentiment was so strongly highlighted by Prabowo in particular, and often in a spectacularly aggressive fashion. But even gently and often with good humor, by Jokowi and other candidates as well. So I think this year has seen a doubling down on bad policy that might result in it being harder for Indonesia to move out of the middle income trap in coming years. In a public fashion, in all the campaigns, including on television advertising by PDIP prior to the April campaign, as well as in the presidential campaign, Jokowi and Prabowo, all conveyed an ambivalence at best, and or with Prabowo, a rabid hostility towards, one, trade liberalization, two, foreign investment in Indonesia, and three, imports. Imports in particular are bad, and PDIP had a series of advertisements before the April election highlighting the damage that imports do to Indonesia. In fact, I think if you could give a bumper sticker to the economic dimensions of the election this year, it would be exports yes, imports no. But it doesn't work that way, and yet this is the new conventional wisdom in Indonesia. And specifically, there was repeated emphasis from both candidates on the need for Indonesia to be more nationalist, and in Prabowo's case, fiercely nationalist, on Indonesia's natural resources. And I think a strong shared sense among candidates, often expressed, I think, gently and more pragmatically by Jokowi, but a strong sense across the political spectrum that Indonesia would rather leave the minerals in the ground than let foreigners have them. And on agriculture, and this was emphasized by both candidates, a strongly populist view that Indonesia should indeed make and produce all the food that it consumes. This has also become a given. It's part of the new conventional wisdom in Indonesia. So it's not at all about food security. It was very much about food self-sufficiency. And the phrase self-sufficiency is the one that Indonesians preferred to use during the campaign. And I don't think that's a good way for Indonesian consumers to get access to quality food at good prices. So while I'm delighted as anyone else that a democratic reversal has been averted, I believe we should be concerned that democratic politics have given this year broad, and I think often enthusiastic, endorsement to what I think is an incorrect view that Indonesia and Indonesians themselves have somehow not benefited enough from the country's tremendous rise over the past decade. I think what was exacerbated in the campaign was the ongoing SBY-enabled policy support and endorsement of something that the World Bank, I think, cleverly termed in a report in July as Indonesia's twin myths. The myth that Indonesia imports too much, therefore, to fix that, import less. And that Indonesia has enough, in fact, not that Indonesia has enough, Indonesia has too much foreign direct investment, and that's fueling this outflow of resources to foreigners. There remains, and I think has been strengthened throughout the SBY era, a perception that FDI, foreign direct investment, is something of a temporary embarrassment that Indonesia must endure until such time it doesn't need to rely upon foreigners enough. Yet the reality is, on a global comparative basis, Indonesia gets a fraction of the foreign direct investment it needs to grow rapidly and to become a high-income country. And there are no examples of countries that have succeeded in that transition who are attracting the kinds of relatively low levels of investment that Indonesia is attracting. And yet, so the public discourse in the election of believing Indonesia gets too much foreign investment or not enough on the right terms, I think probably doesn't position Indonesia well for moving forward. And I'd add two more to the myths that the World Bank mentioned, and that is, and both candidates mentioned this repeatedly and often quite an articulate fashion, that the state sector needs to be expanded. Not the state sector, the state-owned enterprises, many of which are gloriously corrupt and been dumping grounds for cronies for decades, but this state sector, which is unaccountable and untransparent, needs to be expanded in order for Indonesia to be more prosperous rather than privatized or made more transparent. And finally, and this is absolutely critical of enormous importance to Indonesia's trading partners, and I think to Indonesians themselves, that free trade deeply disadvantages Indonesia. In no democratic election anywhere in the world, with a handful of exceptions, do candidates go out of their way to endorse free trade. But very few places do they also go out of their way to talk about how bad trade is for a country. So let me say a few things about the anti-foreign sentiment in the campaign that was highlighted in the first part of Ed and Marcus's presentation. In fact, it's so startling, the vehemence of it, that you would have to go back a long time in Indonesia to find examples of anti-foreign economic sentiment being expressed publicly like this. Probably, Greg Feele and I were chatting last night, perhaps when Amin Rais held these views in the 1990s and expressed them quite strongly. And then before that, you probably have to go back to the Malari affair of 1974 to find a time in which such currency was given to negative perceptions of foreigners' economic role in Indonesia. And of course, it's the first time that anti-foreign investment sentiment has become an important part of a democratic election since democracy came to Indonesia in 1999. And this was alluded to by Marcus or Ed a moment ago, that there was a perception among foreign businessmen, a lot of analysts in the country as well, that this is just campaign rhetoric, and after the election, all will be well. No, not at all. I think it's the biggest urban myth of Indonesia this year. It's simply the full-throated public expression of sentiment and policy already endorsed widely by the bureaucracy and the policy elite, including some graduates of ANU. Prabowo is hostile and aggressive on the subject and unyielding. Jokowi, on the other hand, tended to avoid talking about foreign investment. He never went out of his way to criticize it. But when he was asked, or when he was prompted in the debates, either the five presidential debates or the extensive dialogue that was held with Kadin, which was a four-hour affair, he also generally endorsed views of the need for more protectionism. But thankfully, I hope, for Indonesia, balanced with what appears to be a healthy dose of pragmatism. In that sense, he sounds similar to Megawati, strong in the rhetoric, but practically and pragmatically much more thoughtful. For me, the most telling exchange on economic policy during the campaign was in the presidential debate, where Prabowo thought he had a win on this one, and he just drilled in on Jokowi and said, but wouldn't you abrogate or renegotiate those natural resource contracts that disadvantage Indonesia? Jokowi said no, and he didn't take him at that, and he asked him again. And Jokowi said, no, I would read the contract, and every contract is different, and if the contract allows us to renegotiate, I'll renegotiate, but only according to what the clause allows. I think we saw then and there what it means that we don't have an oligarch as the candidate then or the president now. Indonesia has a real entrepreneur and businessman who himself has had trouble in his career, challenges ensuring that contracts are honored. So I think that was a very hopeful and pragmatic thing. But he also said, once the contracts for these natural resource contracts are over, these concessions, mining, oil and gas and so on, of course they should go to Indonesian players and the state sector should get first crack. State sector should get first crack. So I think that although Jokowi was reasonable, very reasonable, by comparison and thoughtful to Prabowo, his pragmatism shines through repeatedly in the campaign, in his answers, and he's been very engaged with the international and Indonesian business community since then in a thoughtful way. The reality is that he has endorsed views on economic growth, which have typically not been recipes for success throughout Asia or in Indonesia's own history. The final thing I would address, because it's come up repeatedly, and it's just to give you a flavor, the candidates were asked quite a bit, actually, again, endorsing what Marcus said earlier, this is a very substantive campaign. A lot of questions, Indonesians and reporters and journalists were interested in the ASEAN economic community. This came up a lot. What's Indonesia gonna do? Both candidates said that looming ASEAN economic community was something that Indonesia should be wary of. That even though Indonesia helped lead the negotiations and it's coming in a few short months' time, Jokowi said repeatedly that Indonesia belum siap bersaing, harus dilindungi, and that foreign companies should be made a little bit more difficult for them to compete in Indonesia. He had a very nice turn of phrase. He smiled, actually laughed at it. It was almost cute, but he said, well, when it comes to foreign companies, they shouldn't be participating in a level playing field, and the regulatory environment for foreign companies, particularly with reference to the AEC, akan dipersulit sedikit. So again, we can deal with this, we can live with this, but it's not necessarily the direction Indonesia probably needs to go in, and there is no question that Indonesia's neighbors in ASEAN are deeply concerned about this. So while we have the most robust private sector credentials of Indonesia's leadership in 70 years, not only the most, the only time Indonesia's had a president and a vice president who are both genuine entrepreneurs rather than rent seekers, although Yusuf Kala had a stint as vice president before, nonetheless, running a real business. I think this is hopeful for the country. However, when it all comes down to it, my greatest worry, based on what we've heard in the campaign and what we heard repeatedly, again, these weren't just one-off comments, and what we've seen in the policy statements, is that if Indonesia under Jokowi continues, this is my closing statement, if Indonesia under Jokowi continues SBY's policy of steadily restricting investment, shunning FDI, remaining deeply skeptical of the benefits of trade to reduce poverty, hostile to the private sector, then Indonesia in 5 years' time, given, I think, Jokowi's very admirable focus on health, education, infrastructure, could find itself a little bit healthier, a bit better educated, mildly improved infrastructure, but well and truly stuck in the lower middle-income trap. Thank you very much.
Okay, many thanks, Doug, and our speakers. We have between 10 and 15 minutes for questions from the audience. We have microphones either side, so raise your hand. I'll take about two or three at a time and we'll answer them. Okay, I have one here down the front. They're all down the front. Anyone? Okay, let's take, Merle and John, and here John as well.
Okay, thank you. Merle Rickliffs. I just wanted to ask Marcus to go back to the question about party machines. I've been among those who think there's not much in the way of party machines. The voter loyalty is very low, and the people shift votes around on individual judgments. But you were suggesting that the figures show that the parties did turn out the vote for Prabowo. Now, of course, you went over the figures quickly. I may not have followed them, but I had the impression that those figures, and indeed the trend in those figures, didn't vary dramatically from what was happening in the populace generally. That is to say, you can only make the case for the parties mattering if the party turnout, the people in those who voted for those parties turned out for Prabowo in a much larger percentage than the general populace did. So could you just have a look at those figures again for me and show me that there's a significant difference in the turnout between the parties and the general voters?
Okay. Do we have a microphone? Oh, okay, we'll go to John Monfrey. There's just down here. Just use your voice. We can hear you, John. Just.
Learning new things every day. Thanks to Marcus and Ed and Douglas for all of that coverage. Two things. I was struck by the use of the word oligarchy, which I haven't heard used all that much in Indonesian politics, but I'm very familiar with it in Philippine politics. And I was wondering if the political scientists are taking a number of parallels from Philippine politics. It's notable, for example, in the Philippines that provinces there are virtually the fiefdoms of certain political clans, and you've seen a little bit of that in Indonesia, especially, say, in Banten. And secondly,
just keep it short, John.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, and secondly, the role of Yusuf Kala might be very, very interesting. Can I have some predictions about how he'll approach the vice presidency this time? Will he be as active and aggressive as he was before under SBY?
Okay, thank you. And one more here.
You didn't allude to it more than offhandedly, but from a distance at least, it would appear that this past election was notable, the presidential election, for the sharpness of sort of religious cleavages in the party alignment, as well as in the rhetoric. How important, interesting, do you think that might be?
Okay, we have a microphone here.
Number one, to Merle, I think the numbers that are presented are pretty clear. When the campaign started, the patterns were all over the place. You had a lot of PKS voters going for Jacobi, you had a lot of Golkar voters for Jacobi. Once these parties, the leaderships of these parties, had declared their support for Prabowo, these voters started to shift. That's the only argument I make. I make no arguments about whether that relates to the populist stance. What I'm saying is that the party campaigns on the ground, very, very obviously, looking at the numbers, show that they had an effect on the voters that supported the parties in the parliamentary elections, then initially declared their support for Jacobi, but once the party machine started to operate, they shifted to Prabowo. So that, I think, and I was one of those researchers over a long period of time who said that actually there's very little evidence that political parties and their machines matter much in presidential elections. But looking at these numbers, I'm now convinced we need to revise that stance. I leave the first part of John Monfrey's question to Ed on Yusuf Kalla. I think actually he will find that his role as vice president will be much more limited than it was under SPY. And we see the first indications of that. He is clearly frustrated with the way he was left out in the preparations for setting up the transition team, and a lot of other policy issues that are now being discussed were also developed without him. John's question, very interesting one about the religious and ideological component of the election. It's very interesting because you have Prabowo, who actually couldn't care less about Islam ideologically, and he's said so many times, and he said recently once again how frustrated he was with PKS and having to pretend that he actually has any interest in their agenda. So from that regard, it was not that significant. However, he had planned to run it this way. It was very clear that, you know, he had PKS on his side, he had PTIGA on his side, he had FPE and all of the Islamic radical militias on his side. He ran a smear campaign against Jokowi that was clearly based on a radical Islamic idea of, well, if we just claim that he is a Christian, we'll win this election. So clearly the election was run and implemented as one that appealed to the ideological sentiments of Indonesians, but that said very little about what these candidates actually believe.
Just very briefly on the question of the oligarchs, I noticed Vedi Hadis walked in before, so perhaps I should just say you should read Vedi and Dick Robison's book. But in fact, you know, there's a large interest now in the question of oligarchy in Indonesian politics, and the term is usually used for very wealthy individuals whose wealth is at least partly derived from special access to state resources or to state power. So it certainly is a major debate now within the general literature on Indonesian politics about the role of oligarchs, the role of clans and so on. I mean, perhaps we don't have the time to get into that now, but certainly there are interesting comparisons to be made with the Philippines. I'll leave it at that in the interest of more questions.
Okay. All right, more questions then. See some hands. Okay, right up the back, we have one. Any more? Okay, and in the middle, two in the middle, hard to get to. So let's see. Okay, please. So
my
just
name
one question.
My name is Harun from the University of Canberra. I just want to have one question. Last 2 days, the Compass Daily, there is an essay that Mr. Yusuf Kalla will reduce the subsidy for the oil, and it means that Yusuf Kalla will have a very economic-based policy in the next few years. And in contradiction with the Vice President now, do you think in economic policy this is the worst Vice President in the last 10 years? Thank you very much. Do you think that the current vice president has the worst economic policy that he contributes in the last 10 years?
Do you think?
Thank you very much.
Okay. All right. Did we get a microphone into the middle?
Yeah. Okay. You mentioned a number of times of Jokowi's pragmatism. Why do you suppose he's promoting nationalism instead of encouraging direct foreign investment? If he's a pragmatist, why doesn't he see the benefits of direct foreign investment? Do you think it's possibly just politicking, populism?
Okay, and we had another one. Thank you.
Is this on? Yep. Tim Kolbach, freelance journalist. Marcus, I think you mentioned that money politics, or Ed, I can't remember, one of you mentioned that money politics had played a very big part in the, admittedly, I think it was in the parliamentary campaign, but I'm wondering what part it played in the presidential campaign. Is it any part of the explanation for that rise in Prabowo's vote? How much do we know about how determining a factor it is compared to all the other things? I really find it very hard to believe that 15%, that Jokowi lost 15% because people thought he wasn't running a good enough campaign. That just seems illogical to me. And was it linked to that growth of party loyalty? How is it handed out? What do we know about how it was the machine of handing out money actually worked?
Okay, thank you very much. Will we just stay seated and, yeah.
Hello. The first question on use of colour. If I understood you correctly, you are saying that the idea to reduce fuel subsidies is his policy. In fact, it's not. It's a policy that Jokowi deeply believes in. It's a policy that his economic advisers deeply believe in. And in fact, the preparations for cutting the subsidies are very well underway now. As far as I understand, these negotiations do not include Kala. On your second suggestion that he is the worst economic manager in the last 10 years, I have no comment on that, but please, you know, I think it's very clear that Jokowi is the one who's driving the cut in subsidies, and as we've heard from so many economists over the last really 30 years or so, that this is something that really, really needs to be done. Oh. Okay, we leave that to the economic section then. Sorry,
I think that to the question of Jokowi and why does he prefer national companies over foreign companies? I don't think it's that. And I don't think he's particularly hostile to foreign direct investment, but he's pragmatic. Look at his track record in Jakarta. He wanted companies that really could build subways to build the subways. This was the incredible breakthrough after 30 years. Rather than having a crony company do it, he insisted that they be high quality Japanese firms that actually knew how to build subways. But then he very pragmatically paired them with unfortunately, I hope not too unfortunately, the deeply corrupt city-owned construction companies to do the infrastructure work around them. So I think that it's not particularly for or against foreign companies, but his default position has been that if Indonesian companies, state or private, can do it, that would be better.
So on the money politics question, it is true, I think, there is a really stark difference between the parliamentary and the presidential elections in terms of retail vote buying. So that is distribution of cash and goods to individual voters. And the reason is that in the parliamentary election with the open list system, candidates are investing their own money or money from donors in their own political careers. Whereas in the presidential election, individual party operators or candidates indeed not only often feel disinclined to invest their own money for the good of their presidential candidates, but they also went into the presidential campaign not having much spare cash left because they'd spent it all during the parliamentary campaign. And the difference was really clear. So I met one vote broker, for example, in a district in central Java who'd been in charge of distributing cash for a candidate from Hanura, actually, in the parliamentary elections. And she said, I'm just not going to get involved in the presidential campaign because it's really embarrassing. I don't want to have to go to people and ask them to vote and not give them an envelope with money in it. However, it is true that cash counted a lot. But like I think Marcus mentioned in passing, so there was a lot of cash lubricating the Prabowo campaign, but it mostly went for funding the machinery. So it kind of went to local political elites, or local social elites, or social leaders. So people like kiai, or village heads, or community leaders of one sort or another. And that was really very clear when we did some observations of the campaign in, again, parts of East Java, that the Prabowo campaign was awash with a lot of cash for that sort of thing, whereas the Jokowi campaign had almost none.
Okay, I know there are other questions and I apologise, but we have run out of time in this session. We need to have some time for a coffee break before we come back for the economics update. Please join me in thanking our speakers.